Today's webinar, The Art of Managing Up, sponsored by Georgetown University Alumni Association and Alumni Career Services. Thank you for taking the time to join us today. My name is Emily White, and I'm the Assistant Director of Alumni Career Services, and our presenter today is John Kaiser, who's an alum and also a business leadership coach. Today's webinar has been very well received by our alumni community. We had close to 170 registrants, so we're thrilled to hear that this is a very hot topic for all of our alums. To begin, I'd like to share a few housekeeping tips and reminders. Today's presentation is being recorded. You can access the replay of this webinar within 3 business days on our website. There are 2 audio options. You can listen via your computer speakers or dial in to the conference bridge number provided. Participants are not required to have a headset, but you're welcome to use one. It is important to note, if you experience audio difficulties while listening through your computer speakers, this can be caused by having multiple software applications open. Please feel free to close some of these applications or join us using the conference bridge number provided in your reminder email. Questions are welcome. Please type in your questions in the question area on your GoToWebinar control panel screen. John is planning to answer as many questions as time will allow during the Q&A component of today's webinar. We will be emailing out the PowerPoint slides afterwards. If you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the chat area if possible. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce our presenter today. John Kaiser currently works with executives who recognize the need and also have a passion for striving for continuous improvement, their own and their companies. He also writes ideas and advice on johnkaisercoach.com each week, intending for these papers to be helpful in achieving success in business. In his coaching practice, he works with executives from CEOs to up-and-comers, helping them become even better at what they do and in their leadership of others, becoming their best selves. John has had a long career as a senior executive with Johnson & Higgins, then after a merger with Marsh & McLennan. His principal responsibilities and his passions were superior client service, understanding specifically what his clients needed and wanted all around the world and delivering to that standard, as well as training and developing his company's people so they can maximize their success. He is a believer in the Tom Peters principle: pay close attention to and take care of your people, and they will pay attention to and take good care of your clients. John is a Georgetown Liberal Arts graduate and also a graduate of the Georgetown Leadership Coaching Program, which is accredited by the International Coaching Federation. He is also one of our favorite webinar presenters, and we're so thrilled that he is here today to share his time and expertise. John, I'm going to turn it over to you.
Okay, thank you. And hello, everyone. Excited to be with you and hope this is going to be helpful. So the first thing I want to do is who we are today. We went through the registrants, and 58% of them are women, 42 male. And all forms of businesses. There are corporations, people with corporations, some with government, and some in with not-for-profit organizations. Just about everybody is a Georgetown graduate. Almost 30% have business degrees, almost 20% law degrees, 16% with the Foreign Service School, and then that leaves 36%. Some of the 36% are graduates of the college, some have PhDs in economics, some are graduates of the School of Public Policy, some are with medical degrees, and some with health studies, and some nursing. So it is really a cross-section of the university. And also, some are from outside the United States. So it's a great group. Everyone wants to do well in business or whatever their profession is. Absolutely everyone does. And so my intent is to share advice, my observations, what I've learned myself, what I did well, what I didn't do well, what I've seen others do well with their boss, not do so well with the boss. And the bottom line is I hope it is helpful for you. And let me first say that the relationship with the boss is extremely important. I'm going to come back to this later in the hour, but it's a very, very, very important subject. So At the end, there are going to be questions. I hope I get to answer all of them, if there are a lot of them. And if not, at the end, you'll see my email address. And we don't get to your question, or if you have a question that you think of later on this afternoon, this evening, or whatever, shoot me an email, and if I can answer it and be helpful, I will. About myself, just very briefly, Georgetown grad. My kids went to Georgetown. I've always been active as an alum. My wife was at one time the golf coach here, and I believe Oya Blue. And the only reason I say that is I encourage everyone to be active as well, and not for what you're going to receive from it, but if you're active with Georgetown, and one of the great things for me is you meet another person that went to Georgetown, it doesn't make any difference what the age difference is or anything. It's almost like there's an instant bond. And it's been a great source of pleasure for me. And I encourage you to be active. And I promise you, good things will come from it. And by the way, a great opportunity to take advantage of the things that what Emily and Bridget run, the Career Services. It's by far the most active university career services program in the country, and so there are all kinds of good things going on, and be part of it if you can. Okay, let me tell you about why we're doing this particular subject today. During an earlier, in February, I did a program that was titled Earn That Promotion with an exclamation point. And at the end of it, I said, you know, I'd love to get anybody has any questions or feedback, issues you'd like to discuss, please email me. And I got a lot of them. I heard from a lot of people. And the interesting thing was every single person I heard from, every single one was an issue with their boss. So I mentioned that to Bridget, and she said, that's got to be a webinar, the subject of a webinar, if that 100% of the people emailed that issue. So that's why we're doing it. And it's almost certain that if you're going to advance, if we're going to advance, our boss has to be an enthusiastic advocate of us. So, and I'm going to get into it in much greater detail, but we don't have a good relationship with our boss, and studies have shown that 50% of the people do not have good relationships with their boss. We've got to try and find a way, if at all possible, to fix that, because it's going to be real helpful to have a good relationship with the boss. It's going to help us do better work, and it's going to help us advance. So one of the things I'd like us to think about, I don't have a PowerPoint slide on a page on this, but one of the key qualities of success in a leader is self-awareness, and in fact it goes back to actually the Ignatian principles of Jesuit spirituality, and one of the foundations is self-awareness, what's important to us, and One of the key things is how are we received by others, how are we comfortable with others, what's our relationship with others. And so I'd like us to think about our presence with our boss. Are we tense with our boss? Are we uncomfortable with our boss? Or in another case, I know I have two people I'm close to, friends, who simply have a problem with authority, and they just seem to rebel against anyone who is an authority figure. And let me tell you, it is hurting them in their business careers. And I try like crazy to subtly, I'm not coaching either one of them where I would be in a much better position, but I really do think it's a hurdle to their success. And So as I said before, everybody wants to be successful. I certainly think that anyone who has a Georgetown degree is certainly in a position to be not only successful, but very successful. And so think about the business. We're going to get into more details about how you can have a good, productive working relationship with our bosses. I know in my 40 years, I had some great bosses who I had really, really great relationships with, and a couple that I did not. And someone asked me, and I mentioned this in the previous webinar, if I could look back and change a couple of things in my four-year business career. The two things that jumped out at me were two bosses where I just kind of tolerated it, them, and I wish I had developed a good relationship with them. And I think it would have been better for me, better for them, better for my teammates and so on. But okay, the scenarios. Our current boss, or we get a new boss, and the third thing is a boss where we just have a problem. And one of the things I'd like to start with is shouldn't be adversarial. We should look at our boss as our teammate. Our boss should look at us as a teammate, and that's what we're trying to set that tone, that environment. Too many situations. I coach a lot of people, and I hear from a lot of people because I write every week and on my website, and a lot of people write back to me and say, you know, I like this, or I didn't. I don't agree with this, or I have this question, or whatever. So I hear from a lot of people, and way too many people, it seems, feel intimidated by their boss, and they're looking for their boss to be perfect. And of course, their boss is not perfect, nor if we supervise other people, or if we ourselves have direct reports, they certainly don't think that we're perfect. And so it's just not going to happen if we're looking for the perfect boss. And a lot of people seem to be quick to be critical of their boss. Now, studies have shown that in 50% of the time, it is, you know, we do have a bad boss. And, you know, the boss is not a good leader, or he's a manager and not a leader, or doesn't share information, or it doesn't help us advance in our career, all kinds of stuff like that. So it is a fact that half of us have a boss that is not a good boss. But are we going to let that affect our career? We've got to somehow or other fix that relationship so that we can move ahead and we don't let a bad boss be a roadblock to our own advancement. The best way, in my mind, absent some circumstances that are, you know, but just in general, the best way to approach that, I think, whether we have a relationship or a good relationship, good working relationship or not, is absolutely fundamental. We need to know what the boss expects, needs, and wants from us. And I think it's very appropriate for us then, once we get into this conversation, to explain to the boss, look, we're on the same team. I want to do great work. And I would like to share with you what I need from you as my boss to help me do my best work, which is good for me, good for you, good for the company. And so it's absolutely imperative that we know what success looks like for us. And it is also good, very definitely so, to know what success looks like for our boss, because we want to help our boss succeed, just as we want her or him to help us do good work. So This is absolutely the most fundamental thing. It's to understand what success is for us and what our boss expects, needs, wants from us. So if there's one thing that you take away from this, it's this particular slide. Just a moment here. Okay. I watched a great video early this morning on the internet about vulnerability. And to me, allowing ourselves to be vulnerable is very attractive. I have said in my previous seminars about career advancement that striving for continuous improvement, which takes humility, admitting that we can be better. But I think a great thing to do is to ask, to tell people, your boss and actually peers and even people who may report to us, to say, hey, I'm working on a couple of things that I'm trying to do better. Please give me your feedback. I would appreciate that. That is a very attractive thing to do, and I encourage all of us to do that. And the soft skills, it could be said, and it is in a lot of high-achieving organizations, that intelligence is a given. Doing good work is a given, that everybody there works hard and does good work. May or may not be true, but in a lot of organizations it is. And the difference maker can be the soft skills. And handwritten notes is something that makes a big impression on me. A guy who I used to work with came to town recently, and we had lunch and had a great discussion about business and stuff. And a couple of days later, in the mail, I got a thank you, handwritten thank you from John. Thank you very much for taking the time. Good to see you again. I appreciate your sharing your insight with me. Well, I don't know whether my insight was worth the price of lunch or not, but I was impressed that he sent me a handwritten note. And I don't mean to embarrass Emily White, who's in the other room on this telephone, but Emily sent me a handwritten note recently, and I love that. So I just think it's a good idea to do it. The soft skills can really make a difference. Soft skills, being with your boss, trying to be comfortable, really comfortable eye contact, and affirmations on what she or he is telling us. Doesn't mean you can't disagree, but disagree nicely. And listen to learn. Don't slouch. Don't cross your arms. There was a person here here in Washington that I had a meeting with, and I got so angry because he sat back, leaned back, arms crossed across his chest, and, you know, at the end of the meeting, I just had no particular desire to do business with this person. So it's being direct and sincere, and I guess the bottom line is to be easy to work with. Are we easy for our boss to work with? And we should try and be. More general principles would be being early for meetings, delivering reports, if at all possible, ahead of due dates. And I had a woman that I worked with at Johnson Higgins, Christine Masala, who eventually rose to be the top person in the entire industry. But one of the things that I just loved about her was when we would be working on a proposal or a study that we had to deliver to a client, and it would be a big deal, she would break it down into parts and start early and give me drafts ahead of due dates, and we would deliver the final proposal and the draft early, and it was so impressive to our clients. It made such a huge impression on me, and I loved working with Christine because of that. And I used that story many times with other people whom I worked with to to do that. So we want to be encouraging, a source of positive energy. We want to be a great teammate. This is all part of being a great teammate, and we need to think of our boss as a member of our team. And the next one, focused on being receptive, not right. This is huge. A lot of people take great pleasure in trying to correct their boss or whatever. And if they listened to learn and just wanted to be receptive and not correct, jump in and try and correct the boss, but to be receptive to the information, be far better. And so this is important. I mean, and I'm not saying don't correct the boss. I'm just saying don't try and listen with the intent to do this. So listen to the with the intent to be receptive. And certainly at the end of the day, we want our boss to know if we do have a good relationship and she is helpful for us to let her know that we appreciate that. This came up in the last webinar in it was beginning of April. It was Earn That Promotion Part 2. Someone asked the question, and since it relates to the boss, I thought I would mention it again. If we're getting dumped on and the work is overwhelming us and we're overloaded, what do we do? And I had mentioned then, and I thought it would be worth mentioning again, if that's the case we're in, if we're being overworked and we get a new project put on us, we should sit down with our boss and explain that we're not trying to get out of it, but we need to know her or his priorities because there's a lot of work to do, and we want to know that we're doing the highest priorities and what the order is. And here I would like to turn this to you, and I would love you to email in right now on what do we want from our boss. Help us succeed, want us to communicate clearly and often with us, ask our opinions, our feedback, and our ideas, listen intently to me and my colleagues, appreciate me, help me feel part of the team, appreciate my work and my value, or all of the above. It's okay to answer more than one unless it's F, all of the above, then only do that. But please do that now, and we will share that shortly, what the answer is. Let's take 30 seconds and do that.
Great. Thanks so much, John. I just launched the poll. Unfortunately, we couldn't include the last one. We only have 5 multiple choice options. So if those on the line want to vote all of the above, just send me a chat, and I'll enter that into our data, and we can share the results. Give us a couple more seconds to cast in their vote. Let's see. All right, so the results are in, John. So we had 36% said that they most want from their boss for them to help them succeed. 20% said communicate with me clearly and often. 2% say ask me what I want. 2% say listen intently to me and my colleagues. And 39% said appreciate me and my work and my value. So it looks like that last option was the most popular.
Value me and value my work and also help me succeed was the second, right?
Yeah.
Okay, good. All right, that's interesting. Thank you for doing that. And to be honest, that tracks with national and international surveys. So we're normal. if we do not have a good, productive working relationship, we must try to make it better. A problem discussed is a problem half solved. And just a moment, I'm catching up on my notes here. I really think that this is one of the most important parts of this particular webinar is knowing that half of us do not have a good boss, but we should not let that derail us or hinder our advancement in our careers. So you know, we gotta have to try and work it out. And gotta point out that, you know, I think it's gonna take some guts to sit down, but it's something we have to do. I mean, in order to be successful in business, we are gonna have to at various times step out of our comfort zone. And in this particular case, we may have to swallow our pride and just say, you know what, we're teammates. My success helps me, you, and our organization. And go back to that, what do you want, expect, and need from us, and then be ready to share what we need from her or him. And the person may not communicate, may not be interested in our own success, may not show that she or he values us and our work, which came out most important to us. And then we're just going to have to explain that. And not in an accusative way, but just like, may I share what I see and what I want? And I would like to know that you do appreciate me and my work. Let me tell you one thing, that point I'd like to make, and that is it's almost certain to come back and hurt us if we have loose lips and talk about our boss is a jerk, or our boss doesn't do this, that, or the other thing. Loose lips in an office or in an organization is just not a good idea. Let's do this ourselves, one-on-one with our boss. Unless you run into something ethical, then that may be something we have to do with human resources. But if it's a question of communication, if it's a question of our boss is not showing us the respect that we want, and that doesn't seem to value our work, I encourage us to do this directly with the boss. And if at all possible, we should try to depersonalize it. So it's not about her or him as a person. It's about their behavior. And let's not make judgments about the person. I go back to the question of, you know, I want to do good work. I want to be a good teammate. I want to help you. In your mind, what does success look like for me? And you might be tempted, or we might be tempted, to fight back, but it could hurt us. And that's not the attitude to go in. The attitude is to be solution-based. My older sister, I was married to a guy, my brother-in-law, who was always looking to have a fight with his boss. His boss was always a jerk. Every company he worked for, his boss was a jerk, and the guy ended up to be, I hate to call my brother-in-law a loser. He was a great guy in many ways, but in business, he was a loser, and it was always the other guy's fault. And it was always the boss was a jerk. And the poor guy never made it, and he had a lot of potential. So I guess that's, you know, one of the things that I read recently, where we do not have a good productive working relationship with our boss. Okay, let's sit back and think about it. Make a list on the left side of the page of the things that bother us about our boss. What does she or he do that we don't like? And then on the right side of the page, strategies to diffuse that and to try and work it out. The bigger person is going to work it out so that make every effort to be proactive and to somehow or other develop a good working relationship with our boss that's going to help us, help our company, and help our careers. And so it's really being a solution-based, heading towards a solution-based discussion with our boss. And I think it would, you know, it's what does the boss expect and want from us, and what are our problems, and what's our strategy to overcome those problems. One of the things we want to know is her style. Think about, you know, if she's analytical, then maybe she wants detailed summaries of our work or on a weekly basis, or we can't assume anything. We've got to ask her what good communication looks like. I had one fellow I worked with who actually worked for me who was super expressive, and his deal was I learned that I encouraged him to do this. Every Monday morning he would stick his head in my office and say, hey, boss, here's what happened that was good last week, and here's what happened that wasn't so good, and here are my priorities or our priorities this coming week. And I knew enough that he talked very, very quickly, and I would scribble some notes. And then I would go to his office on Tuesday or Wednesday and stick my head in and say, hey, Larry, how are things going? How's this and how's that? And it made him feel real good about himself. And he loved to communicate with me because I knew how to communicate with him. It worked. And so if we have a problem with our boss, you know, what's the cause of it? What could we do about it? An interesting thing is if both our boss and we are conflict avoidant, how do we handle? So we've got to figure that out, but we've got to, the bigger person will figure out a solution. And a couple of times in my career, I wasn't the bigger person that I wish I was now. So, you know, it's having a good relationship with our boss is not taking all the credit for ourselves, but to acknowledge our boss's role. To if we have a new boss, this is particularly important. A boss that's new to the company or new to our team or something, do we share knowledge? Do we help her succeed as we hope she will help us? And it's the little things. Again, it's thank you notes. It's sending a copy of an article you think that would be of interest, or it's sending a book that there's so many good books out now about leadership and about all kinds of business things, and some of them are like $10, $15 type little red books that are terrific. And bringing in a Frappuccino, if this is a success, if she's a Georgetown or Stanford or Michigan State grad, and you run into a baseball cap, bring it to her. Just things that make her feel appreciated and good, and that she knows that she too is valued as we want to be valued. She should, our boss should feel valued. Now, this could be dynamite, and I'm going to ask you all this afternoon or tonight or in the next, say in the next 24 or 48 hours, but try and do it in the next 24 hours, if this one piece of advice that you would like to give to your boss, just write it in and mail it in, and email it in to Emily. And next week, Emily and I will synthesize, collect and synthesize, and share back to you the advice that we, each of us, would like to give to our boss. I think it will be real interesting and could be real valuable. And, of course, we will protect everybody's identity and the name of the companies and stuff, but I think we could get a wealth of rich information that we would like to give to our boss. So please do that if you can in the next 24 hours. That could be very fun too, and we'll get it back to you next week. So I would love to, if there are questions, I would love to answer them now, and if you think of something later on, please email me. But I enjoyed talking with you. I hope it was helpful. please know that this is a critically important subject. I know so many people who have problems with their boss, and I just encourage them to work it out, because it is so much easier to get ahead if you have a good relationship with your boss. I had a guy, boss by the name of Bill Dunn, when I was working for Johnson Higgins in New York, and we just got along great. I mean, he was, we didn't necessarily have a lot in common when we started out, but God, I loved working for him. I think he loved having me work for him, and we had a great relationship, and it just made life so much easier, and I didn't try to make him look bad. He didn't try to make me look bad, and there were plenty of times either one of us could have done that, but we liked each other, and we helped each other, and we had a lot of fun together. So if I had a model, it would be my relationship with Bill Dunn. So I just want you to know that if you can get that kind of a relationship, it's going to help your career enormously. So, Emily, are there questions?
Yes, we've gotten a lot of questions in, and just to remind folks that they can submit their questions through their question area of their GoToWebinar control panel screen. John, one of the questions we've received is, what is the best way to address or approach a situation where your colleagues approach you for things that they should be asking your boss for because they see your boss as largely incompetent?
Say that again.
So it looks like this person is wanting to know the best way to address a situation where their other colleagues are coming to them for things that they should be going to their boss about, but because the boss is incompetent, they're going to this attendee on the line.
Yeah. Well, great question. You know, I would maybe walk through this. You're going to receive the this PowerPoint presentation, and maybe you should run through it with the person and help the person work it out with direct, you know, encourage the person to directly work it out with the boss. It sounds like our webinar attendee is doing the boss's work, and which is fine, but it's not ideal. I think the ideal thing is to encourage your teammates to sit with the boss and say, if I'm be honest with you, you know, this is what I need from you, this kind of information, and I'm not getting it now, and you know, I'd like to be able to get it from you. I don't know whether that's the best approach or not, but that's my reaction is, yeah, it's great that you do it, but you're doing your boss's work, and that's okay. That's not the worst thing in the world, but the best thing in the world would be to help the boss step up and be there for her or his teammates. And so maybe it's the whole team getting together with the boss and saying, this is what we as a group want from you, and hope you can deliver it, and we're here to help you. I don't know, but that's my sense. Is it's a great question, it's a problem, and if you can work it out rather than continuing to do the boss's work, that would be best. Okay, another question.
Another question we have, John, is someone on the line who's a woman has had very mentoring and successful working relationships with male bosses. The bosses have always coached her to be direct and do all it takes to learn as much as possible, and she acknowledges that this mentoring has helped her along the way. However, she's noticed that she's never been able to have a great working relationship with any of her female bosses, particularly when the female bosses are just about her age or younger. Do you have any specific thoughts on that?
No, except I've heard this dynamic over and over. In fact, a couple of weeks ago, there was a book signing event here at Alumni House, and Christine Brown Quinn, I think was the name of the author of the book. She wrote this book, Step Aside, Superwoman. And one of the questions from the group was a woman who has a big job here in Washington, and she talked about this, that it's a problem, women mentoring other women. And she and Christine got into this conversation, and of course you read about it. I hope that it goes away over the years, as I think it stems from when women were new in the professional ranks, and there were so many hurdles for them that they looked upon other women as competitors. And also stems back from going way back, women didn't play as many sports as men because there weren't, girls didn't play as many sports as boys because there weren't girls' teams. They couldn't, and guys got to be, learn that other guys on their team weren't their enemies, they were their teammates. And so I think it's history, but I think it's happening way less now. I also think that a discussion about it, I go back to a discussion, a problem half solved is a problem discussed is a problem half solved. I think if you have a woman has a female mentor who's not helping her, I think it's bringing it out, putting it on the table. And I think the woman would, hopefully the mentor would turn around and see the light and say, gotcha, thank you for sharing that with me. And yes, I want to be a successful mentor. And I'll tell you, if that's not good enough, send me an email. There's lots of good material on mentoring, and I can refer you to some good articles and some good books. But the mentoring relationship is, it can be very, very, very important. And so you deserve a good mentor, and if you don't have one, try and make it good or get another mentor. But there's lots of good stuff on that. Okay, thanks.
Thanks, John. Another question we have is the person doesn't want to, this attendee doesn't want to sound needy, but she understands that she has a need to be recognized and valued at work. What do you feel like is the best way for her to ask this from a boss who is well known for not recognizing folks or for recognizing only the ones that she thinks do the work?
Without knowing the personalities, it's tough to give a definitive answer, but I think it's, again, sitting down and saying, can I have an honest discussion with you? I appreciate you for all your successes, and I have to be honest with you. I'm working hard. I think I'm doing some good stuff. I want to get ahead. I want to do good work. I want to be successful, and I need the same from you. I need to know that it's one of the most important needs that people want from their boss. And so I need to know what, I need your feedback. I need your honest feedback. If you don't think I'm doing good work, explain that to me, and let's discuss it. If you do think I'm doing good work, I'd love you to tell me. And I'm not just looking for praise. I'm looking both ways. I want to know what you think I'm doing well, and I want to know about what you think I could do better. Excuse me. But that's what I think about that, and it's a great question, and it's very important.
Thanks, John. Another question we have is someone wants to know, how do they manage their time well and plan for advancement and work when her boss often flies by the seat of her pants and tackles deadlines as they come up and is really proactive? It seems like this person often is given projects last minute and wants to make sure that they're able to manage their time and advance in the organization.
Yeah. Again, I think it's explaining that to the boss that, if something gets dumped on you, ask about priorities, but then just kind of nicely say, hey, I love working here. I want to have a great relationship with you. You can help me a lot, and I want to earn advancement. But can I tell you what I see? And that is a lot of last-minute thing. I think it would help me and our team if there was more planning. So, I mean, you know, honesty is always the best approach. I just try and do it in a solution-based way as opposed to a critical way.
Great, thank you. We have one question related to what you were speaking about earlier with the loose lips term. This person on the line has always worked in a mutually respectful environment with bosses who have always clearly advocated for her. In her last job, the office was rampant with what you refer to as loose lips at all level, although she was not a participant. However, this made it difficult for this person to trust her colleagues and peers from the get-go and ultimately affected her working relationship. How do you suggest approaching a situation when most people around you are speaking poorly about their bosses or colleagues? At what point does it make sense for you to remove yourself from the situation or even the job?
Wow.
Yeah.
And, you know, I believe in business, if you can be the change you want to see, try and do it. But this is a real difficult thing. If it's rampant, I would just try and say to our coworkers that, hey, negative energy is just affects us. It brings us all down to a low level, and it doesn't help anyone. If that doesn't work, I think I would go to the HR department on a confidential basis and say, I'm not talking about names. I'm not, you know, this is our problem. This isn't particular people's problem, but this is what I see. I think we should work as a team or as an organization to change this. And, this maybe we need to go to the outside to bring in consultant or coach or something to help us, but it's going to hurt our overall performance. And if nothing happens, then you don't want to be part of that kind of an organization that's rampant with negative energy. But I try and be the change you want to be first by trying to take a positive approach and seeing if you can affect change directly with your coworkers, and then if not, seeing if the HR department will respond. But you don't want to be accusatory or mention people's names, because that will come back. So it's just, we have this problem, and it's not about people, it's about we. And then if they don't do anything, then it may be the wrong organization for you to be with. Okay, I don't know what else to say about that, but it's a bad problem.
Yeah. Lots of questions are coming in. One is related to, John, what do you think this person should do if they have a boss who sometimes takes out personal stresses out on their employees, and this person's been burned out in the past by this type of dynamic? Do you have any suggestions on how, moving forward, they're able to keep this from happening to maintain a positive relationship with their boss?
So the boss loses her or his cool?
Or she takes out her stress on her employees.
Yeah, I would. I hate to go back to this, but a problem discussed is a problem half solved, and I would have that problem with the boss, and without being accusatory or just this is what we see. We want to help you, and we know you have a lot of stress in your life. It could be family. It could be all kinds of stuff. But, this is what we see happens. And how can we help, and how can we avoid this, help you avoid this from happening again? Because it's not good for you, and it's not good for us. So I would encourage that kind of a conversation.
Thank you. All right, let's see. when someone starts to interview for positions, when they're growing in their career, do you feel like they're just as much interviewing for the person they're going to be working for as much as they're interviewing you for the position? So perhaps if you have any tips for when you're interviewing for positions, what to look for if you're interviewing with your potential boss?
That's a great question. I would be upfront with the person you're interviewing with, if that person's going to be your boss, about expectations, needs, what do you want, what would success look like for me, how are you there to help me, what kind of communication are we going to have, what would great communication look like to you, how am I going to be able to share information, what will help me, it's just trying to, yes, I do think you could look at it as you're interviewing her or him as well, and I think that's a great thing that, in fact, it could not only help you, if you could get the job and choose to join that organization, it could really be a great help, but I think it's a great approach to make sure that you lay the groundwork, the foundation for a productive working relationship up front. And I think it can be done in a very nice way. Look, I'm real interested in this. If I do join this org, if you offer me the job and I accept it, I want to hang the moon and I want to be real successful. And I have some questions for you. I want to know what success looks like and how are you going to be able to help me just as I'm going to be there to help you. So great question. And okay.
Thank you. One question we have is, do you have any tips for building trust and a space to work independently with a boss that tends to be a micromanager?
Another great question, and trust is so important. I think it's the subject of discussion again. There's some great written materials, articles. I don't think you can ask the boss to read a book, but there are some. I have one friend who I do not coach. I wish I did because I know I could help her. But when she delegates work, she tells the person exactly how she wants it done instead of just saying, this would be what success looks like. And, please do your best. If you need help, let me know. And I'd like a status report but let the person do the work as she or he, as we see fit. So, I hate micromanagers. And I think the best thing is, I want to do the work. I want more responsibility. I want a chance to be successful. Tell me what I can do. And I would really, if possible, could you let me use my own judgment as to how to do it well? If I have a problem, I promise to come discuss it with you. But I see you micromanaging, and I'd love you to maybe give her some copies of some articles. And again, if you email me, I could find some good stuff that would be, two or three pages about. One of the things a boss wants to do, should want to do, a leader should want to do, is help their people be successful. And micromanaging does not help a person be successful. And it's one of the things that we want from our boss to help us be successful, and the way to do that is not being a micromanager. So I think it has to be discussed, and we can help her or him recognize that this is behavior they may not be aware that they're doing it. Some people are not aware that they're micromanagers, but it's not good. So I'm glad glad you raised it, and I think you should tackle it whatever way you can, and email me if you'd like, but you want to put a stop to it if you can. Okay.
Great. We've gotten a couple questions related to performance reviews. Do you have any general advice on how to perhaps deal with a performance review if you and your boss do not have the best relationship, or perhaps ways to best prepare for performance reviews when your boss is evaluating you?
Well, it's year-round feedback. It's everyday feedback. It's constant feedback. And performance reviews, I mean, they're a necessary evil, and they're somewhat ineffective. And so I think I love the idea of sitting down with your boss and saying, so these are my areas, these are what you think, and these are what I think are areas of improvement. I'm going to have a development plan, and I need and want your feedback year-round. And so that when you see something, or when we leave a meeting, or please don't hesitate to give me feedback. And in fact, I would like to be able to come and ask you for feedback. Far, far, far better than annual performance reviews, which bosses hate to give. People don't necessarily welcome, because usually people aren't honest. What you really want to do to get ahead is to have relationships with your peers, even your direct reports, and definitely your boss, where you're comfortable and allowing yourself to be vulnerable and asking for feedback. So that's what I would do, is definitely, this is a great subject. Just say, okay, I know I can work to be better in a couple of areas. This is what I'm working on. This is my plan. Please, 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 I'm going to ask you for feedback. And if I don't ask you, feel comfortable offering me feedback. I will welcome it, because I want to do good work for you.
Great, thank you. We've gotten a couple questions related to your thoughts on finding a mentor outside of your relationship with your boss, and the best way to do it. Is this something that you ask your boss for recommendations on, a mentor at your office place? Do you find one on your own and let your boss know about it, so you don't offend them that you might need someone in addition to them to help you path your career?
Again, it's tough for me to give an answer. It depends on the organization and what is common practice there. I mean, in some organizations, there's a formal program that HR is involved with, and where people volunteer to be mentors. You go to HR, or so without knowing the organization, what the general practice is, but I think that having a mentor can be a great thing. And there's an organization called the Center for Creative Leadership, and the website is www.ccl, Center for Creative, so it's ccl.org. And they have a little publication that's 32 pages, I think, on mentoring. And it's a great little, I mean, there are all kinds of books and articles, but this is packed with good information. And once you have a mentor, I would read that book yourself with your mentor. And so both read it. But it's an important responsibility for the mentor. And the mentor needs to understand, ideally, will understand what or his role is. And so I don't know how you get the, you know, it depends on the organization. Some organizations through HR, some organization would be your boss would recommend someone, and some organization just got to go find the person yourself. And I think you'd find a person who is well-respected, who's active, a doer. You want a person who's a doer and a giver. And so I pick the person based on your own observation. You know, sure, it's ideal if the person's very senior, but I think more important than that, It's a person who's respected, who you feel is a doer, who's accessible, and is, most importantly, a giver, who wants to help other people, has the security that, you know, quiet confidence in herself, and wants to help other people. So it depends on the organization, but I like the idea of having a mentor if the person's going to really work to help you learn and grow. So that's my answer to that.
Great. Well, thank you so much, John. We've had so many questions today. It looks like, unfortunately, we're running out of time, but it's really great to see that this is a topic that alums are really, it seems like a lot of people struggle with this, and this has been a great session. So thank you so much. And I'll turn it over to you if you have any last-minute comments. But just to remind everyone, the line will email out the PowerPoint slides. And please email me at acs@georgetown.edu with your thoughts related to your proposed advice for your boss. And we will share those with the group later on this week.
Yeah, okay. Well, thank you for tuning in. I hope it was helpful. I sure want it to be helpful. So I appreciate it. I'm happy to hear from you guys if something pops up, another question or issue that you'd like to discuss. I will try and email you back with any advice I have. But again, thank you. It's my privilege to be with you this afternoon. So thank you very much. Take care.
Thanks so much, John, and have a great day, everyone.